Yeah, great question. Actually, I'll start by saying that here at Emory, there's a freshman, so the incoming class, usually there are about 18 to 20 students. And I taught this course for about 8 years. It's called Harem Tales, because in a more orientalized version, it's called Harem, whereas the word has Hara and Ma, which is Harem, right? And so when I meet these students, I ask them, what is it that draws you to this course called, Harem Tales? And the answers are really interesting, because this is what people think about the harem. The answers are, isn't this like a space where, all the women lounge about naked, and then the sultan comes? Often they say sultan, and then the sultan comes, and they're awaiting, pleasure. And there's a black eunuch holding grapes, and so that's one imagery. Another student called it a nunnery. Another student said, isn't this about just, lot of sex in this one place? So there's a whole sexualized imagery of the harem. I want to just speak about where that comes from. And this comes from actually the unavailability of the idea of harem. See, harem is a very sacrosanct space in the history of Islam. The earliest usage of the harem is actually to the most sacred two cities in Islam, Mecca and Medina, right? So they are the if you will, Haramul Sharif, so to speak. But over time, somehow the idea of harem has become this idea of women living behind the walls. They're completely segregated. Their veil, all of these kinds of things. If you take the example of the Mughals, okay, Babur and Humayun, as I showed in my first book, these were wandering, peripatetic, nomadic kings. How did they claim their kingship? How did they think that they were illustrious kings? By drawing amazing genealogical connections, for example, to Timur and Genghis Khan's 5 generations earlier, who were their forefathers, or by acts of chivalry. Babur had won 3 times the seat of Timur, Samarkand. And this was a great, every kith and kin of his family line fought over Samarkand. So this idea of the space runner, right? That formed the king. Or the great adab, the comportment, how do you meet, when do you meet? These were the things that were really critical to the kingship of Babur and Humayun. With Humayun, once he ascends the throne in 1530 in Delhi, a more formal courtly ethic begins to emerge. But he's still wandering, he's still moving. He gets defeated by Sher Shah Suri, he goes to Iran for over a decade, then comes back. It is under Akbar, his son, the 3rd Mughal emperor, that you have the beginnings of what we can see, the early concrete Mughal splendor in the form of cities, in the form of houses, in the form of palaces. So Fatehpur Sikri, the red sandstone Fatehpur Sikri, is actually the first city that has the first walled haram that is established, right? This is a very important thing to remember, but it is not that Akbar chooses arbitrarily to form. He has, by this time, the Mughals have arrived in India, right? There's massive territorial, holdings, taxation system is being formed, administration, there are marriages with Rajputs. So the settlement is absolutely necessary, right? The wandering and peripatetic ethic remains. But not like Babur and Humayun, right? It is not, parts of Central Asia to Afghanistan and on to India constantly. There is peripatetic ethic, but within the Indian subcontinent. So, and it is very important for Akbar to claim those grounds of sovereignty. He wants posterity to remember him as this great monarch. And it is part of that seeking the legitimacy that he commissions the first official history of the empire, which is the Akbarname, right? And it is part of this ethics that he wants, Abul Fazl, amongst others, of course, create, launch this emperor in various writings. So whether you take the Akbarnama, you take the Tariq-e-Alfi, you take any number of accounts, Badayuni, with all his rant, is actually really thinking through, the sovereignty of the emperor, and scores of, paintings. I mean, why is Hamza-nama being cast at this time, about the great victories of the prophet's, uncle, manuscripts of that kind. And so the haram is part of that. But the way he conceptualizes haram is by philosophically, that is in the words of Abu Fazl and others, by linking it to the philosophy of, the spaces of Mecca and Medina. In other words, that, this haram is, Haman-e Padsha is sanctum sanctorum, that this is where women are elevated, right? They are lifted, they're sacred. They are on high because the emperor is on high. They are an extension of him. Nonetheless, his aunt Gulbadan will not have it because for the first time they are declared Pardegyan in the history of the empire. This is instituted in the Ayn-e-Aqdi, right? Which means the veiled ones. So it's a huge shift from a nomadic ethic to a more settled splendor, right? And part of this is, let's say, domestication of women. So haram is that, right? This is the beginnings of the haram. But the point is, as I remind my students, the haram doesn't hold women's minds. They do not hold women's curiosity. So, but how do women respond to this charge? It's very interesting. They're not going to respond like you and me, right? They're not going to say, to hell with it, I'm going, right? But Gulbadan does that. She says, to hell with it, I'm going. But she uses the language of Hajj, right? She takes 11 women, which is an extraordinary, unparalleled incident. And she goes to Mecca and Medina, right? And the remarkable thing is, and this is, something that I've been lovingly agitating over. What made her stay in Makkah and Medina for 5 years? Right? Yes, she's doing the Hajj, but the interesting thing that's coming out is also people writing on the Hajj show that the Hajj for women was not just piety. There was so much else that was involved in it. So these are things that we have to, think about when we think of spaces like the haram, because the spaces are not just that spaces happen and then people are planted in it and somehow we are locked and we are finished. We are thinking as we are today, people were back then thinking, their life, wondering, how to be, how to live, how to accept that. You don't just accept something that's been laid down in the books. We never have. So I think that's the imagination or, the history around the haram that we need to bear in mind.
And there were some pretty powerful women staying inside, especially the matriarchs.
Yes, yes, indeed. And I just mentioned Gulbadan, but there's, there's Akbar's mother, Hamida Banu Begum, who's a classic matriarch in that, she's an interesting person in that, that she's, after the early, there's a very beautiful exchange when Humayun wants to marry her during the, wandering peripatetic times. And she says to her mother at that time, I want to marry a man whose collar I can touch, not a man whose skirt my hand doesn't reach. Now, this is so laden with meaning about, what kind of life he has, the issue of, this is pre-rights language, but I'm using it, but, equality of status. What is my status going to be, with this man who's lost, so much of his kingdom and so on and so forth. But this woman, by the time Akbar ascends the throne, is a very classic matriarch, which is that she's besotted by her son, and the son is equally besotted by her. I mean, the Akbarnama is so rich in how wherever Akbar is, she gets to meet him, right? She comes to meet him. And so she doesn't go to the Hajj. She's already performed the Hajj in the 1560s alone. So she doesn't go on the Hajj with Gulbadan, but she also stays back because when Akbar goes to Kabul against his half-brother, she serves as the governor of Delhi. So there are all these things that really tells you about how exactly the power of women and the reliance of men on these amazing
men on